I'm Rhonda Schapfler, business correspondent and business anchor for NJPBS, part of the WNET Group. I am pleased to be joined by Jorge Pérez, chairman, CEO, and founder of Related Group. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
I want to go back to the beginning of your career to start. You got involved in public housing in the Miami area in the 1970s. You then created Related Group in 1979. What was the atmosphere like for real estate development in the Miami-Dade County area at the time, and what was the vision you had for your company?
Rhonda, I started as an urban planner doing neighborhood development. I became the head of planning, the head of community development. And a lot of what we did were housing programs that were affordable to people in lower income locations around Miami. This led to me desiring to do it on my own, and I became an affordable housing developer. In those days, one of the reasons that I became an affordable housing developer is that I had no cash. I wanted to continue to do good, i.e. serve a population that was highly underserved. And the federal government in those days really provided almost 100% of the equity that was needed to build housing. In those days, the sort of the great American dream of having a quality home to live in was much more popular than now. The government was spending more in trying to provide housing for lower income households, both elderly and family households. And they came up with a program called Neighborhood Strategy Areas, in which they would take whole neighborhoods, and the federal government, working with local governments, would give them deep subsidies. And we were able to get 500 units in a lot of small buildings that we totally rehabbed for a low-income population. And that's the start of my housing career. Rapidly, we worked very hard, I think, and very efficiently. We became the largest affordable housing developers in the country in the first couple of years. And since then, you know, our real estate company, you know, has gone into a lot of different areas, mixed-use projects, condominiums, retail offices, and so forth.
You've held on to that affordable housing component. There is such a need for affordable housing in this country still.
Whatever we build, whether it's very low income, moderate income, workforce housing, is immediately taken up. The demand is far, far greater than the supply. While the federal government is still active in affordable housing, the level of production is not as much as it used to be. We have forged very important partnerships with local governments, mostly in the South Florida and Tampa area, in which we're actually doing thousands of units through a combination of federal funds, state funds, local funds and land, and us as the private sector. So it takes government and the private sector to make these projects workable. There is never enough. Most governments talk a good game about affordable housing being very important, but what I call the NIMBY factor, not in my backyard, is still very prevalent in most cities, particularly those higher income cities that really are not doing anything to provide their fair share of housing.
You have spoken about the need for a thriving South Florida. Explain what that means for our viewers.
Well, South Florida went from being a strictly tourist and retiree community to one in which we started developing both our transportation, educational, and cultural facilities. One of the big changes was Art Basel, which is a huge art fair coming to Miami. And the second largest, believe it or not, was COVID. You know, people saw some of the older, more dense northeastern cities suffer through COVID, suffer through buildings that did not have the access to open spaces and air that we have in Florida, and made not just a let's go there during 2 weeks in the winter, but let's move to Florida. And when they came here, they saw that they really liked Florida. So we've had a huge influx of corporations, not just people wanting to buy second homes, but corporations that they're transplanting themselves either regionally or totally to South Florida. And that's had a huge impetus on the growth of Florida. So money gets money. These people are investing. So everything right now is very rosy in spite of the economy not doing as well as we would all like it to do.
Do those recent changes in the last couple of years change the way you approach development or think about development in Florida?
Yes. You know, particularly in our condominium division. Before, condominiums in the urban areas where we like to be and specialize in, we do not believe in suburban expansion. We love to have thriving central cities. Before, most of the buyers that we had were from South America in South Florida, particularly in Miami. Like I said, with COVID and the heavy taxation and problems in northeastern, northwestern cities like Chicago, New York, Boston, and even in California, LA and San Francisco, we're seeing this huge shift of business. So we've adapted, you know, our marketing programs, our type of buildings that we do to satisfy not just the South American people that always see Miami as the capital of the continent, but also the northeastern buyer. What that has also done, which is good and bad, is it's made a huge increase in prices and in rents. So what would rent for one is now renting for two. So affordability has become even a bigger issue. We're 98% occupied and in all our market rate buildings. Of course, affordable housing is always 100% occupied. And that has pushed rents to a level that is very disturbing to me in the sense that we either put somebody in an affordable housing unit, which there are very few, or we force them to move very far away from the employment centers, which is something that is very detrimental both to the environment and the huge amount of traffic that it produces and to the people that have to travel those long distances and waste so much time.
Do you see anything on the horizon that would reverse that trend of those rising rents?
Unfortunately, I don't. The only thing that could reverse the trend is for the government to start spending much larger amounts of money to subsidize housing. You know, when I build an apartment, and if it's 1,000 square feet, say, you know, the subcontractors and the contractors don't tell me, I'm going to charge you less because it's affordable housing, right? So we have to pay the same prices. Land, when I try to buy it, they don't say to me, I'm going to charge you less because it's affordable housing. So the deals that we have done have required visionary governments like Dade County and Tampa that have said, here's land, we're going to give it to you as long as you build affordable housing, and we're going to go to federal governments to get further subsidies. When we build affordable housing, the profitability of affordable housing is much, much lower than building a condominium or a market rate rental. The risk, of course, is much less because they get occupied right away. So the only way that I see a change would be if we could increase supply tremendously by either making more land available for nothing or deepening the federal, particularly the federal and state subsidies, you know, dedicated to affordable housing.
You're interested in sustainable and inclusive communities. So how does Related Group approach both identifying and coming into undiscovered neighborhoods, if there are any undiscovered neighborhoods, really, based on what you're telling me in terms of just the rapid change?
There are undiscovered neighborhoods and there are undiscovered cities, you know. So we look at income levels of households. We look at growth, immigration into certain areas, and we compare both neighborhoods and cities with each other as to rent and price levels. and you will find discrepancies that we like to exploit. So, for example, we take a neighborhood, let's say, what Wynwood was. Wynwood is a neighborhood in Miami. It's now become the Soho of Miami, right? It's now chic, and there's a lot of art, you know, artists, art, and so forth. Well, Wynwood was nothing, but when you looked at it, it was in the middle of Miami and had some interesting buildings. So we made a huge bet on Wynwood. Alapata now, which is next to Wynwood, is experiencing the same growth. So right now it's probably too late, you know, to go to Wynwood, although people are still paying like crazy to go to these areas. But the trick is in discovering the areas before they explode, you know. And I think we have been very good at that, not only in identifying those neighborhoods that are ready for growth, but also in identifying cities where we see differences in supply and demand and rent structures and price structures that we feel should not be. So, for example, when we looked at rents historically in Dade County and South Florida, and then in Tampa, for example, we saw a city that was ready for major growth, and we made a huge investment in Tampa and were able to secure great land parcels at prices that were minuscule compared to the prices in Miami. And they bet has paid off. You know, it's probably our second largest, you know, city. And we did the same thing in Atlanta, for example, that we thought they had depressed prices compared to where it should be. So we are constantly looking at those growth patterns to determine where we're putting our investments.
I want to switch gears a little bit. You speak about a fair, just, and equitable Miami and have donated millions to the Miami Foundation to support the mission of building a more prosperous Miami. Why did the foundation speak to you?
You know, I came from a country, first of all, I came from parents that lost everything in Cuba and were left penniless and had to go to a foreign country to start all over and get at middle age. Even then, my parents always taught us that unjust societies could not be sustained over a long time. And then we saw the unjustness with people that were very, very rich and people who were actually starving on your way to school, you know. This always stayed with me, and I felt that people that were lucky enough to succeed and were given the opportunity, like this country gave me the opportunity to succeed, had an obligation to try to make it an equal playing field for everybody. And that means access to opportunity. So when I look at the Miami Foundation, and we work very closely with them, we try in all the areas that are of interest to us and are interest to them to make this an equal playing field. And that could be having public housing, elderly people, families, having children from public schools that are, you know, that do not have access, you know, to have programs in which they can visit the museums, go see plays, go see an orchestra. We have a big program for scholarships, you know, in which students have to be not only needy financially, but also very bright and willing to work hard. We have community development programs. We have training programs for employment. We have medical programs. My wife is a nurse practitioner, so we cover that. So we try to spread the money in a way that creates, like I said, and trying to create an equal playing field for everybody, because it's unfair for somebody to compete when they haven't had any of the benefits, you know, that a middle class or upper middle class child will be. And that goes everything from the home life to the education to the access to educational and cultural opportunities. This is very important. That's why it became a part of the Giving Pledge, in which 50% of whatever I have is going to go to philanthropy. And the other thing that is very important for me is I treat it as a business, in the sense that every quarter we hire an outside firm to check on all the nonprofits that we give the money to make sure that they are following their mission. So if they say they're going to educate 25 children, we want to know that's happening. If not, we will switch their funds away from them to those that are performing what they say they're going to do. So we hold everybody to the fire. The same thing we do with scholarships. We expect them to maintain an average in order for us to continue to contribute to whether it's an individual or an association.
So I've been listening to your story. You're a self-made man. You care about philanthropy. You're civic-minded. You, your wife, your family, giving millions of dollars away. If you could reflect on your 40-year career in real estate, how did you strike that balance? And what is the message you want to deliver to emerging developers in urban centers across this country? Talk about your recipe for continued success.
Well, the balance is not, for me at least, right? I did not strike that balance right away. You know, I'd be lying to you if I said, hey, from early on, I spent half my time looking at art. You know, I spend 100% of my time trying to make a business. You can't spread the wealth unless you have the wealth. So I think in your early stages, particularly if you say that I'm a self-made man and I really did start with nothing, you need to work very, very, very hard and concentrate totally in the business part. Like when we do philanthropy now, and for the young developers, this would be my advice too. My two sons that are most involved in the company are now not so much a part. They see the reports and they attend the meetings, but not so much part of the family philanthropy. My daughter, who is a social worker, my wife and myself, do that with the staff that we have, because their role now is to learn and grow the business. And that's more than a full-time job. When they are more at ease with that and they develop their own senior staff. Right now we have a great senior staff that we've been with for many, many years, but as they grow, these people will get older and they will have to develop their own set of great developers and finance people and so forth. They need to very much concentrate on that now for at least the next 10 years until they feel much more secure in being great at what they do. And then they can devote time to giving back to the community. And I would advise that to everybody. When they tell me, you know, what do? I say, you know, you got to work harder and smarter than anybody else, because we are in the most competitive country in the world. You know, if we miss, there's 50 developers that are out there that will take our place. And we don't like to be second fiddle.
Clearly not. Jorge Pérez, thank you so much for sharing your story with me today.
Thank you very much for having me.